We should find out soon whether the federal government has signed off on BP's new proposal to recover more leaking oil. A decision was promised late today. Almost 100,000 barrels of oil have been collected as we near the two-month mark in this disaster, but that's just a drop in the bucket after researchers doubled their estimate of the flow rate yesterday. The Obama administration says it's pouring resources into the Gulf, spending about $140 million on the cleanup so far. A new warning today that oil could destroy the Gulf marshlands and affect millions of birds that migrate there during this winter season for generations to come. President Obama returns to the Gulf Coast Monday for a two-day tour of the spill areas he hasn't inspected before. He'll be back here in Washington on Wednesday. At that time, he'll confront the chiefs of BP. I asked the president's point man in the Gulf, Admiral Thad Allen, about that and more. You wrote a letter this week to the chairman of the board of BP, effectively summoning him and his other top executives to come to Washington next week to meet with you and to meet with the president of the United States. I guess a lot of people, when they read that letter, they said, what took so long? Why is it taking so long for the president and for you to meet with the chairman of the board of BP?
Well, Wolf, as you know, as I've stated many times, I have a frequent daily contact with Tony Hayward. I also meet with members of the board of directors, for example, their managing director, Bob Dudley. And I deal routinely with the Secretary Napolitano, Carol Browner, the White House, and I have frequent interaction with the president. So there's a flow of information. There is contact both ways. I think it's a logical progression to bring everybody together, have a very focused meeting on the issues that both BP has and the issues that the administration has, and it's my job to facilitate that.
That meeting will take place, I assume, at the White House next Wednesday. Will Tony Hayward be at that meeting?
It's my anticipation that he will, and part of my job today, once I finish the press issues that I'm dealing with right now, is actually to work with both BP and the administration on the agenda for that meeting.
On the agenda, and the president will participate in some of that meeting, is that right?
That's correct.
Do you trust BP?
Well, if I get the trust question all the time, here's what has to happen with BP. We have to have collaboration, we have to have unity of effort, we have to have cooperation, we have to achieve effects. To do that takes a wide range of personal relationships and communications. And when we speak, we have to have some assurance that when we're getting accurate information and we can exchange views very, very frankly. You can characterize that as trust, you can characterize that as any way you want, but that is what we have to have, and that is what I'm trying to create as a National Incident Commander. That's what I believe I have when I deal with the officials at BP.
How worried are you that BP could go broke?
Well, you know, that's not my line of work, Wolf. Right now, they are a going concern. They are the responsible party. We are dealing with them that, and my assumption is that will be that case moving into the future unless conditions change.
And this whole impact that this is having on U.S.-British relations, a lot of folks in Britain are suggesting the U.S. government is being way too tough on BP. What do you want to say to them?
Well, Wolf, my job is to try and create unity of effort and focus all the resources on this response. I'll leave foreign relations and that stuff to the State Department and the political leaders. My focus is on this response.
We're going to have much more of the interview with Admiral Thad Allen. That's coming up later here in the Situation Room. I'll ask him about the new doubled estimate of oil flow and about local officials' complaints that they still don't know who is really in charge. The Gulf oil spill may be putting some strain on the United States' special relationship with Britain. The British media are urging the Prime Minister, David Cameron, to stand up for the embattled BP that was formerly known as British Petroleum. Cameron is expected to talk on the phone with President Obama this weekend. But Britain's deputy prime minister is downplaying talk of any diplomatic rift.
It is an ecological catastrophe. It does need to be dealt with. I don't frankly think we're going to reach a solution to stopping the release of oil into the ocean there any quicker by allowing this to spiral into a tit-for-tat political diplomatic spat. So. I and the whole of the British government want to only play our role in as much as we can, a constructive role, to find a solution to what is a huge environmental disaster.
Let's bring in our senior White House correspondent, Ed Henry. He's working the story for us. It's a problem right now, even though the leaders probably are trying to downplay it.
They really are, but this is very early in this new important relationship between the U.S. president and the new British prime minister. So it's clearly testing that. This phone call has now been scheduled for 11 a.m. Eastern time here tomorrow. The president will be doing that in the Oval Office. And clearly, Prime Minister Cameron under heavy pressure domestically for him, because as you noted, there's some feeling in the UK that maybe there's been some Brit bashing, if you will, here, number one. Number two, a lot of people there are taking a hit in their pockets, because BP has lost about 40% of its value. BP is in a lot of the pension funds there in the UK, so that's a big issue. But then there's the competing domestic political pressure here for President Obama, and he got some cover today from House Speaker Nancy Pelosi, who said, look, the issue is not about beating up on the British. It's about the fact that this company has not been honest with the American people.
They misrepresented the number of barrels, the amount of oil that was being spewed forth into the Gulf, and continue to do so. And the scientists now have an update of the minimum of what is in the Gulf, much higher than what BP said. And again, third of all, when they start telling you to cut your hair and send golf balls and diapers for the cleanup, you know that's not the technology of the future.
And White House aides are stressing that while BP will be an important issue on this call, there's a lot else on the agenda. Of course, these two leaders will also talk about Afghanistan, et cetera. But let's face it, even after this phone call, next week, President Obama, as you were just noting, is going to be meeting with these BP officials here. He's going to be pressing them to make sure they're paying these claims, et cetera. So it's a very tough balancing act. He's trying to keep our relations with the UK in a good place. But at the same time, he's keeping the heat on BP, Wolf.
It's not going to get any easier either, Ed Henry, at the White House. Here's a look at BP's response to the oil disaster by the numbers. The company says its cap on the leaking well has now captured more than 88,000 barrels of crude. BP says almost 3,600 vessels are involved in the effort, and that more than 2 million feet of containment boom have been deployed. The total cost of the response so far, more than $1.4 billion. Let's get to the disaster zone now, where crews are using every weapon possible to try to stop the oil from tainting more of the coast. Brian Todd went on a boat tour with the Louisiana governor, Bobby Jindal.
Wolf, the frontline battle against this oil spill, part of it starts right here at this makeshift landing pad in Burris, Louisiana. You've got a chopper behind me. They come every few minutes to pick up 1,500-pound bags of sand. Let's watch him pick it up right now. He's about to lift off a couple of bags. They're taking these out to Pelican Island and Schofield Island, a couple of the other barrier islands around here, dropping them into gaps in the island to prevent oil from kind of sliding through those little gaps in the island. This is not the berm construction. That's separate. That's going to be filling in gaps between islands. These sandbags are designed to fill in the gaps in the islands, which a lot of oil is slipping through.
We run 24-hour operations here, so we fill sandbags and stage them throughout the night. They fly out about 800 sandbags a day, and we can fill about 900 sandbags a day when we run 24-hour ops. So we've been able to stay ahead of it so far for the last month. I love it. It keeps as a native here. I was here for Katrina, and I was here for I guess the oil spill. Now it makes a real difference on my heart that I'm able to be here and help.
Brian Todd reporting for us from Louisiana. He'll be back later. Meanwhile, the toll on birds and sea life climbing. Federal wildlife officials say as of today, 504 oiled birds have been rescued along with 55 sea turtles. But 658 birds have been found dead along with 279 TC turtles. Keep in mind, that's just the number recovered. The actual number could be much, much higher. In the Gulf Coast crisis, there's a radical option for trying to pull the leaking plug. A nuclear option, literally. We're talking about a nuclear bomb. Stand by.